if we wait until we're inspired before we turn towards truth, then we'll never do anything. Because rarely are we inspired. Rarely do we feel inspired. Most of the time we feel very uninspired. Like right now, I feel completely uninspired. Flat, nothing. And yet, events have conspired in a positive way to give me this opportunity here on a June 3rd Sunday in 2012 to actually have some time after taking care of a lot of chores, etc. And no inspiration. And yet, here we go. It's often said what success is, well, 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration. And that's very true. Very, very true. So, it's like that for everyone. Don't believe that those that are successful because they're always inspired and it's easy for them. That's a great way to quit and be lazy. It's not true. I believe that those who succeed, succeed because they keep trying even though they feel very uninspired. So if you're feeling uninspired, you're in a good place. That's the norm. Because you're doing it anyway. And it seems as though this is what I'm supposed to be doing right now because there's simply nothing else happening. You know, the quote, life is what happens when you're making other plans, is very true. We think that we need to do all these things and we expect a lot of stuff to happen. And maybe none of that happens. And we might just sit there and do nothing then say, well, nothing's happening. Well, maybe in any event, whatever happens, Satsang has to come first in your life. That's the first responsibility for all of us here. Isn't it amazing that nobody really highlights that, at least in the mainstream at all? They're very busy doing anything but Satsang. Very, very busy. And in fact, a lot of this busyness is simply an excuse. You know, the driving, you know, the van and to the kids to the soccer game and then to the music lessons and to this. Kids are a great excuse, honestly, because people will say, well, I'm way too busy with the kids to attend Satsang. It's interesting that kids don't necessarily want to be that busy. Kids actually themselves want to practice self-inquiry. I know I did when I was young. I didn't really want to be going places or doing things. I'd rather be reading and paying attention to self-inquiries, to Satsang. So a lot of times parents, they use the kids as an excuse because they keep the kids constantly booked, scheduled every minute of their day, of their lives, helicopter parents, and they feel they have a perfect excuse. Though they're too busy with the kids, they don't have time for Satsang. We use the world like that as an excuse. We're too busy making money, seeing the world, going places, doing all this stuff. And at the end of our lives, many look back and they'll realize they never spent a moment in self-inquiry. And they can say, well, I was too busy. But is there really any valid excuse at all? The answer is no. There's no valid excuse. None. Parents can still attend Satsang. They can still, I'm out here, there's all sorts of stuff going on, cars coming, going, motorcycles going down the street, dogs, all this stuff. You know, doesn't it bother me? The kids can be out in the front yard playing, and one can be around in the vicinity if any trouble arises. One can still be then focused on Satsang. One doesn't go into a blanked out condition. still aware of what's happening around, but it's not a sharp focus. You're not trying to micromanage this the external world. And kids will appreciate that. Really, they don't really like to be micromanaged. So there's no excuses. Even the very best excuses here are no excuses. And again, feeling tired, uninspired, etc. I feel that way all the time. It's no excuse. And we think, well, if we feel uninspired, we'll get nowhere. Not true. It's like on a long hike. You're tired. You're thirsty. Your body's aching. You've been on the road for a long time, and haven't had a good night's sleep as you're out, camping, and still you have to get up and take the next trek, go up to the next lake somewhere. You don't feel good about it, but you realize that if you just put one foot in front of the other, you're going to eventually, reach that night's campsite, and it'll be beautiful and nice, supposedly. Same thing. Here, we just simply have to keep going. And as we do that, we reach better and better clarity. We come across something we never saw before. We'll say, aha, wow. I never really saw that before, how I'm held back by this really stupid, plausible, illogical formulation. And then you're able to feel how that's unimportant, and then you're less held back. It goes like that. There's more activity. Unexpected, unusual activity. I was sitting out here earlier, and four Harley Davidsons came roaring down the street, full throttle, blasting, absolutely reverberating the entire neighborhood. Never seen that before. And then a helicopter came over real low. That too shattered the tranquility, but no excuse, here we are. Now the dog is barking, you see. Doesn't matter. Because we know that this, the perfect, pure, immaculate stillness, peace that is present right now, is not being affected. There are no ripples being caused in that. And it's right there for us. All we have to do is sidle up to it and decide to experience it. And just the common inertia of the planet really prevents us from that. Which is sometimes why people feel they have to change the whole world before they can ever be free. What they mean is they have to try and break all that inertia, but it's too difficult. That's not the answer. We do have to break our own inertia, even though we're feeling quite uninspired. Why? Because the world is very uninspired. We live in an uninspiring time, uninspiring place. Everybody is distracted. I wonder how many people today in this, out of 7 billion, are spending several hours on satsang today in self-inquiry. Out of 7 billion, how many? How many do it on a daily basis? See, whittle the numbers down. We're talking about maybe a tiny drop in the bucket. So it's this collective, again, I've said this before in other videos, the collective inertia, lack of will. And because we are one, we feel that. It's felt. Somehow we have to disengage in that with that solidarity. Because it's solidarity with a fantasy. So it's not, it's really temporary solidarity. And the question is temporary solidarity really solidarity? Is temporary loyalty really loyalty? So let's look at that. Here's our key for this video for right now. And it may not be, right? I mean, if you question it, you see, it's not real loyalty, is it, if it's only temporary? And we say it's only temporary because if this forgetfulness of what we are is only temporary, it has to be temporary. Because the attractiveness of what we are always seeps in, always. That's just how it is. Because we cannot get rid of what we are, and it's supremely attractive to us, and therefore we're always turning in that direction. It's a constant battle to remain in forgetfulness of what we are, constantly. And we get tired of it. So it's a certainty that we will eventually give up the charade of trying to be prime creator, and trying to be separate from reality, try to deny reality. So all aspects of spirit will give that up. So the dream seems to fragment, because there are those who decide to remember what they are. So solidarity with inertia and lack of will, solidarity with forgetting what we are, has to be temporary. It will be temporary. That won't last forever. It will not last forever. So is that solidarity, is that oneness, is that really loyalty? And if it's not, why do we value it so much then? We're being loyal to everyone else by continuing to forget what we are. Why? What's the benefit? Well, the benefit is to attempt to create a oneness out of fragmentation, out of fantasy. The belief that can be done, can be accomplished. And again, that's the belief that we can be prime creator. That somehow we can stitch all this together. All these fragments of a dream of fragmentation, we can stitch it together and have this seamless oneness. And then we can look at that and say, you see, we created this. We're prime creators. Not possible. Because, again, the remembrance of what we are, the attraction, is always seeping in. So people will always be trying to avoid that or turning towards that. So it's always change here. You cannot have some middle of the road. Everyone is just kind of on the fence and then stitch all that together. No, there will be those who are intensely into forgetfulness and those who are intensely into remembrance. And they're going in different directions. They're going very fast. All sorts of stuff is continually boiling. Existence is always boiling. How can we stitch that together? And even when we stitch it together and make the seams beautiful, it's still a stitched together tapestry, not a seamless oneness. And yet, what we're all telling each other is that it should be sufficient to us. If we just all do it together, it will be sufficient. We will all kind of say, yeah, this is enough for us. This overrides the attraction we have towards what we are, and we're satisfied to just remain with this stitched together tapestry, ragtag garment. And we're all trying to convince ourselves of that. Really, that's really what's happening. That's what it was like. I remember in the 60s, everyone would sit around, just say, yeah, man, yeah, this is it. And just kind of look at each other. Everyone's supposed to say, yeah, yeah, we're just chilling here. And this is the vibe, this is it. And you try to get this group think going, you know, everybody's supporting everyone else and just saying, yes, you know, yeah, this is it. This is it right here. This is all we need, this is the vibe. But really, it's more of a hopefulness than truth. We're all hoping that it's the vibe. This is it. We're there. We've arrived. So you get a collective, large group who all believe that they've arrived. Group think like that. But is that arrival? There's another question to consider. If everyone in the world gets together, is on the same page, and they're all liking each other, and they all agree, you know what? We have arrived. This is it. We've arrived. We're all friended. You know, we've all friended each other. So we've arrived. That's it. Does that mean that they've arrived? Does it mean that this arrival is actual? That's the question, isn't it? Is it up to us to determine what reality is? That's another question. Can we collectively determine reality? Set our own reality. Decide this is it. Sit around in a circle. Chant, hold hands and chant and say, everyone says, yeah, this is it. This, we've decided that this is it. Is that it? Is that it? Meaning, will the attraction of what we really are cease at that point? Will we feel it no more? And we think when we have a group and get together and everyone feels very oneness and high, very feeling of commonality, something that feels good. And they feel this is it. And then after it's over, they disperse. And where's the feeling then? That's the question too. The remedy is different than that. It doesn't really require people getting together in groups or doing anything necessarily. It requires just a simple choice from each one, a simple choice to see everything equally overlaid with an effect that's not being modified. That's true equality. Everything. All circumstances, all opinions, all moods, all emotions, all thoughts, concepts, strategies, plausibilities, things, energies, space, time, everything. Everything is overlaid equally. By an effect which is perfectly quiet, not moving, non-moving, not doing anything, not dead, not static, but just simply not being modified. We equate non-moving with deadness, because when something is dead, it doesn't move. But the truth is, when something's dead, there's enormous decomposition taking place. So there is massive movement. In any form that dies, there's all sorts of modifications taking place. Modification doesn't stop when a body dies. Corpses will go through incredible modifications. Change colors, smell different, you know, all sorts of terrible stuff. So that's not the end. Death is not the end of modification. Not at all. And all of that, those atoms and fragments that made it make up a body, they all fragment back into circulation, right? And so they're continuing to be modified. They join up with other fragments and construct something else. And then that is again destructed. So the modification is ceaseless. The death of a body does not have anything to do with non-modification. Nothing. We have to look at that. It's so crucial, because one of the roots of laziness is to believe that once we die, we're there. Okay, we've arrived. certainly there's nothing in the universe which is not ceaselessly part of a constant modification. So there's no effect in the universe that can remind us of what we are. It cannot come from the universe. And so when we say that we need to experience effect that is not moving, again, that doesn't mean it's dead, because death, there's again massive modification taking place. An effect which is not being modified, that is not death, that is actually life. Life, real life, cannot modify itself. It can extend itself, but it can't modify itself. Whatever is, remains as it is. It's extended and added on to. But it's not through fragmentation, it's not fragments, it's a seamless oneness extending and expanding, as it were. No death. So life cannot be modified. So in order to be reminded of what life is, we have to get into experiencing what is not being modified. If we look here in this world, looking out here, I see a tree. I see many trees and bushes and shrubs. I see concrete plaster. I see metal poles. I see concrete pathways, I see stonework, plastics, ceramics, wood, granites, stainless steel, plastics, dirt, leaves, an LED display, computer, the sun, the sky, asphalt. Sound, wind, atmosphere, smells, everything, you know, looking out, all of that. It's all constantly undergoing modification. Our perception may not see it, but the fact is that on this hedge in front of me, many, many leaves right now are dying. Slowly. Imperceptibly to our perception, but if we could zoom in with a microscope and look at it, we'd see that maybe half of the leaves on that hedge are dying right now. The other half are growing. The height of the plant is growing. Bark is being shed. Everything is just an incredible constant motion. Change. The rock is eroding. Little tiny particles of dust are coming off it. It's bleaching. And the soil is in constant change too. Everything is being modified. How can that remind us of what we are? And the answer is it doesn't. So what does it do? It perpetuates this enormous forgetfulness of what we are. So we have to see something else. We have to see it in a different light. And what I say is when we see that a presence that overlays everything and put our attention on that presence, then that will remind us of what we are. And it's the purpose of the presence is also to remind us of what we are. That's its purpose. So it's not a academic, mechanical thing. It's simply there to help us remember what we are. It's not asking anything of it. It's not asking us to fixate on it. It's not asking that we pay exclusive attention to it. It's not asking any of that. It's just there to be utilized. Should we want to remember what we are? Here's the means. That's all. Doesn't even have a voice, doesn't even need to speak, doesn't need to say anything. It's not trying to make you guilty if you turn your attention away at all. That causes no ripple in it. It feels like a gift, a complete gift. It's not asking anything of us, nothing. Nothing whatsoever. It's simply there because it knows, well, our spirit chose that we want to give up the attempt to be prime creator. And it knows that spirit wants to remember what it is. And this effect is simply there as an effect of non-negation, not trying to modify anything. It's not trying to modify itself. It's perfectly happy with itself just the way it is. Not trying to change itself in any way. Not to, making no demands, no demands whatsoever. And so we overlook it. We're trying to get the feel for that. Because that is the remedy that we all must eventually accept. And the feel, we're feeling for it, and it's... It has no agenda whatsoever, none. We simply make use of it. It's like a tool, we make use of it. It's up to us. As we abide in that, we remember what we are. It's that simple. This overlay is not telling us we have to do this, we must do it, we must continue on with it. It's not pressing us, it's not trying to make us feel guilty in any way. Doesn't act out in any way. It's exactly the same all the time. Not trying to change. Not trying to change you. Not trying to change anything. Not trying to change your mind. Some people call that love. They use that term. Completely loving. But it's important to feel into it more than just a term, a word. What do they call it? Unconditional love. I believe that's a term that has been used. Unconditional love. No conditions. None. Zero conditions. And we're still trying to figure out what the conditions are so we can meet those conditions. We know there's something really, really great that we have access to, but we're trying to figure out what are the conditions, and you know, we can't figure it out, and so we're nervous. How come, you know, we figure, well, there must be very secret, there must be very hidden conditions, because we can't find what they are. And so we think, why would this be hiding all its conditions from us, and we get nervous about it. The reason why we cannot find what the conditions are for experiencing this is because there are no conditions. None. So here again, we have brought up a very important key. Is we're nervous because we can't find out what the conditions are, and therefore we don't believe we can meet those conditions until we find out what they are. And the fact is, there aren't any conditions. So we don't have to worry about meeting any conditions. This overlay is there for everyone always, unconditionally. So we don't have to worry about anyone. And the way we help others is simply to say there are no conditions to it. And the way we find that out is we stop searching. I think the famous phrase is call off the search, call off the search. I believe Punja Ji said that, you know, call off the search. Call it off. What are we searching for? We're searching for conditions. We really want it, but we want to make sure we meet its requirements. It's like getting into a prestigious university, or getting a job we really want, or asking someone, a fiancé, proposal for marriage proposal, or all these various things that we really want to be successful at. And so we're trying to determine how can we be successful? How can we be accepted by this overlay, this pure stillness that is present right now? And, you know, do we need to study some books? You know, do we need to really ace the course, you know? Do we really need to, do we need to learn Course in Miracles, for instance? Do we need to remember some quotes? Do we need to, you know, practice all the principles, etc.? We're looking for some way to build up some resume where we will be accepted by this overlay. But the truth is, there are no conditions. And that's resonating with me right now, very powerfully. Very powerful realization. And it almost brings up a laugh. There are no conditions to meet. It simply is freely there, completely accessible at all times, always exactly the same in quality, in quantity, perfect, seamless overlay, no conditions. It's just there. And when we finally drop the search to satisfy some conditions, there it is. But we won't see it as long as we're looking for conditions. I need to go somewhere and chant for 5 years. I need to have an advanced degree. I need to get a PhD. I need to make a lot of money. I need to give a lot to charity. I need to serve the poor and the weak. I need to live a good life, all these things. We're trying to do that, imagining that these are the conditions. We're imagining that these are the conditions. The overlay has never said that. It's never talked about conditions at all. And we wonder, why is it so silent? It never speaks, never says anything. That's what I've experienced. It never says anything. Never gives any answer. I keep asking questions, you know. And as we all do, like, what do I need to do? Just tell me what I need to do. Right? Isn't that where we're all at, really? All in this very same boat. We're all in the very same boat, really. It's very important to hear that. And as we're just saying, tell me what I need to do, and I'll do it. And there's no response, you know. And so we make something up. Whatever it is, and we think, well, I don't know what to do, but I just got to do something. So let me do this. Let me write a book. Let me make a video. Let me go attend a talk. Let me go attend a satsang. Let me do something. Paradoxically, by attending a satsang, you end up hearing that there are no conditions. So you've done the one thing you really need to do, which is, right? That's why I say satsang is beneficial. overlay has no conditions, unconditional, no requirements. Why? Because we're already spirit. We don't have to do anything to be what we are. The overlay is simply reminding us of what we already are. Doesn't require anything of us except to experience the overlay, abide in it. The perfect stillness, the vision of oneness, simply experience it. There are no conditions. If one leaves the experiencing of it, there's still no conditions. Conditions don't develop from it. They don't evolve from it. There's no evolution taking place. None. It's steady. It's completely the way that it is and always will be already. It's already that. And we are already that. We're already spirit. We're just been in a state of forgetfulness. So, I mean, the overlay doesn't go to spirit and say, hey, spirit, you have to meet a lot of conditions before you can be what you are. No. The overlay knows that spirit already is what it is. It's just been in a dream of forgetfulness. And the feeling I have is one of kind of laughter. It's funny. That's what Jesus says in A Course of Miracles. He says, the final step you'll find, you'll simply will laugh. It'll be funny. Laughter, you know, just... not laughter at a joke. I think it's maybe uncaused laughter, I don't know, but it seems very funny. Not funny like ha-ha funny. But laughter kind of like a release of tension, of effort. It's so completely simple that it's laughably simple, you know, like that. It's beyond simple, isn't it? Because there are no conditions. You don't have any to fulfill. No one has to fulfill any conditions. And thereby you give freedom to everyone. You're not asking them. You realize they don't have to fulfill any conditions to remember what they are. To abide in this feeling. They do have to choose to remember what they are. That is the one irrevocable condition that is part of reality. We cannot become something other than what we are. But to access this reminder, no one has to do anything. So everyone has the same unconditional access right now. I can feel, I'm telling you, this is very profound. And they will, everyone will always have this unconditional access right now. Always. There aren't any conditions being laid upon the world. The world simply has already been overlaid perfectly. Conditions, unconditional access. We don't even have to die to access it, do we? Don't even have to be born to access it. It's not asking birth or death of us. It's not asking growth of us. It's not asking anything. There are no questions. It's not like you get to the gates of the overlay and there's St. Peter and saying, you know, let me take a look at your life. No such thing. There's no gate to enter, really. There's no key that needs to be applied. Never has been, never will be. There's no secret password. There's no mantra needed. There's no state of mind needed. There's no position in society needed. There's no particular clothing, types of clothing that is needed. There's no particular place one has to be. No particular age or gender one has to be. Nothing. There's no conditions. And yet everyone is frantically working to satisfy some imaginary conditions that they assume must be there. The ego tells us there must be conditions. And so we turn to the ego and say, oh, really? What kind of conditions? Tell us. And the ego says, okay, I'll tell you. And then the ego puts you on a path. Krishnamurti said that truth is a pathless land. Very true. Very true. There are no paths to it. No conditions to satisfy. None. Never. We don't have to become a good people first. We're just, whatever we're doing, we're trying to satisfy some imaginary conditions that are not there. Nothing we need to do first. It's already there. It's unconditionally there. Unconditionally present. And those who can really get this, that they're there. That's it. And one might say, you don't even have to get it. That's not a condition. Seeing that one doesn't even have to get it either. It's not like you get it first and then you satisfy a condition. No, it's just there. So the state of mind that we have prior to choosing to experience the overlay doesn't make any difference. No difference. So we don't need to remember what it was. It's irrelevant, entirely irrelevant. The ego will ask, well, what was your state of mind just before you experienced this overlay? I need to know this because it's so vitally important. I'll tell everybody. That's the condition that one has to have. Well, of course one will have a state of mind before one chooses to experience the overlay. There's no vacuum, but it makes no difference. Doesn't matter the slightest bit. So the ego will trick us and say, you need to tell the world what your state of mind was, and then that way everyone else can try to reach that state of mind too, and they will be able to experience it. Not true. Because it doesn't matter what the state of mind is. It makes no difference. All states of mind have equal access right now to the overlay because there's no conditions on it. So the answer would be it doesn't make any difference whatsoever. It's a useless bit of information to give. Totally off track to emphasize that. The ego will ask, well, what process brought you up to that? Again, off track, doesn't make any matter. All processes are not needed by the overlay. So whatever process doesn't make any difference. You might just say, well, I was attending satsang or self-inquiry and realized that even self-inquiry wasn't necessary. That might be, you know, a reasonable answer to give. I'm just considering the fact that it's not necessary to consider the fact that nothing is necessary except a simple choice. And the simple choice is not a meeting a requirement, except that it's not right to say that reality is a requirement. Spirit has no choice but to function as it was created. So that's not a requirement. Because requirements can be seen to be either fulfilled or not fulfilled, but one has no option but to function as one really is. To be as one was created to be. Then one has no option. So it's not a requirement, it's just, it is what it is, it's reality. And so, we simply say, okay, we need to remember what we are. We have no choice in that, we must do that. So that's not meeting a requirement. That's realizing that what we are doesn't need to meet any requirements. So we're giving up the fantasy of requirements. Requirements, meeting requirements has to do with trying to become something that we're not, something different, trying to become prime creator. Then there's a lot of requirements there, right? But what we are doesn't need to meet any requirements to be what we are, no. Unconditional right now means it's unconditional for everyone, everyone. So no one is being deprived of help if we enter into the experience of the perfect stillness that's present right now. We're not depriving anyone else of access. Nobody else needs help to access, as it were, because help means meeting some requirement, right? I mean, satsang is pretty much the only help that is needed, which is a simple reminder that there are no requirements. You might say, paradoxically, using speech, that one is required to be reminded that there are no requirements. Because one, prior to that, one is believing in that requirements must be met. So there is, as long as we're using words, there is a requirement to be reminded that one doesn't require requirements to experience the unconditional love, unconditional peace, stillness, oneness. There's no requirements to it. So here we are, we're being reminded of this fact. So we're doing our doing what we need to do. That doesn't mean we're meeting requirements, really. But we're realizing that we don't need to meet any requirements. It's a realization rather than a meeting of a requirement. And the realization is more like a feeling into unconditional non-modificationness, unconditional isness. One might wonder, how can a great teacher comes into the world, how can they seem to just ignore everyone and everything as if everything is perfectly fine? It's amazing, right? They seem to be almost cruel in their indifference to the sufferings of the world. But the fact is, those teachers are really showing us, are radiating the truth that there are no requirements. Everyone right now, this very instant, is perfectly, has perfect access. And if you just extend that feeling, cover all the universe, all the planet, everything, radiate that, that's it. Radiate this realization and abide in this feeling that everyone has equal access. Everything, all has equal access to this overlay right now, and always will have this equal access with no requirements at all, ever. Zero requirements to be met. So the teachers simply radiate that out into the world. That's all they do. They're completely joyful. They're not sad about what happens to people, etc., because they know that these people literally have the access right there, always. They can't escape it. Inescapable. So they see this inescapableness of it all. So why should they be sad? They know that nobody is running away from it, because it's always there with them. It's just that people are trying desperately to come up with, meet some requirements. Trying to become bigger, stronger, faster, smarter. It's all complete foolishness. How can they feel sorry for anyone who right this instant is completely qualified? How can they feel sorrow for that one? We're all completely qualified. We're pre-qualified. You know, it's not like we're going to a bank for a loan. We're all pre-qualified. And we love to hear this, which the credit card companies know. That's why they send us all, you know, constantly we're getting junk mail saying, you're pre-qualified. You've already won. You're pre-qualified. You're a winner. Just go here. You know, and that gets us, you know. The marketers know how to get to us. Very cynical to do that, really. But the fact is, we are pre-qualified because we're spirit. We're already completely 100% pre-qualified. And the great teachers, the gurus, they know that. They see it perfectly. So they look at everybody in that light. Everyone they see, they see one who is 100% perfectly pre-qualified and has no need for any requirements whatsoever, that can this very instant step into that feeling of non-modification, step into that presence, experience that presence. They know that everyone can do it right now if they just stop chasing after qualifications. So they are completely optimistic in that regard. They also see that many will continue to chase after qualifications, requirements, perhaps for a long time. They're very into it. And maybe this brings a tinge of, you know, seriousness to them. I mean, they acknowledge it. Yes, that's true. But it doesn't override the fact that they are not really distancing themselves in any way. And as we have all these qualifications and we look at the presence of perfect peace, and we're saying, okay, you know, how does this qualification apply? And we ask, you know, is this good enough? There's no answer. I really don't think the overlay answers like that at all. It almost requires teachers to speak of it. I believe there is a plan of teachers in the dream, because the overlay itself doesn't speak. It's quiet. Has no voice at all. It's simply, because then if it said something, we would interpret it, but it doesn't have anything to say. It's already here, perfectly here, unqualified here. Not requiring anything of us at all. Not even that we hear what it has to say. Okay. But then teachers point this out, because we're so used to listening and hearing and finding out what we need to do, that we need at least someone to say, hey, there's something that present which doesn't have is unconditional, does not require any conditions from you whatsoever, does not require any qualifications whatsoever. That is there. It is present right now, and that clues us in. So there is the overlay, and then there is that the teaching function which is advising us to that it is there. Basically, it's just spirit reminding spirit that there is a way to have perfect remembrance of what we are. But that this this way, this remedy is present. Even though it doesn't say anything, doesn't do anything. Doesn't do anything. Doesn't give it any special recognition to anything. So maybe we're looking to see if we can be special. We need to develop some sort of talent so that we're recognized for those talents. It's not asking us to have any talents. Its only purpose is there to remind us of what we really are. That what we are cannot be modified. Therefore, since we're one, reality is one, reality cannot be modified. None of it can be modified. And so you see, we started out uninspired, right? I was flat, no inspiration whatsoever. I said, you know, just give it a try, see what happens. And here we stumble into the very heart of the matter. Just because we're walking down the road, well, it's bound to be a positive thing to walk down that road, the road of realizing that we don't need to walk down any road. But as long as we believe we need to walk down a road, we still have to keep walking down it. Eventually that road, the road of reason, the road of the satsang clarification, brings us closer and closer to realizing, hey, I never needed to walk down any road. Nobody needs to walk down any road. Nobody needs to do anything. Pre-qualified. Which is why the teachers, the gurus, seem to act kind of be strange. Can't really figure them out. They'll talk, they'll answer questions, they'll smile, and then they'll just simply lapse back into silence. And maybe inwardly they're chuckling. They cannot make the silence speak. You see? We're waiting for the silence to speak. It cannot speak. Teachers speak on its behalf, but it cannot speak. It has nothing to say. And so a lot of times we're hoping that the guru will get the silence to speak to us and tell us what the requirements are. And really, we come to the guru and say, you know what, I've been on the path so long, I still can't figure it out. And Punjaji will say, got off the search, forget about it. You know, Muji will say, forget about it. Forget about it. I believe that's what they're saying. You don't need to discover anything except the fact that you don't need to discover anything. It must be quite funny for the teacher seeing us jumping through these hoops. What does the teacher need to do? Teacher doesn't need to qualify us. Teacher does not need to have us develop qualifications. We're pre-qualified. Entirely. From the very get-go. Because God created us as we are. And that qualifies us to be what we are. And it qualifies us to remember what we are since we tried to forget what we are. Silence, a great stillness, the overlay, the vision of oneness, vision of Christ, nirvana, etc., has no voice, has no words. It's quiet, entirely quiet. And it's not requiring us to be quiet. It is quiet, that's what it is. It's not being modified, no modification taking place. Beautiful evening, late afternoon. The dog is running all over the place, shouting out, but it doesn't cause a ripple in the stillness. The stillness is not requiring the dog to be silent. The nature of the stillness cannot be changed, it's unqualified. All sorts of people are out walking their dogs. And the dogs are going everywhere. Most of them have the dog on a leash. Some let the dog run free and the dog runs in our yard and tramples the flowers and causes a lot of problems. And life goes on that way. Everybody doing something, filling the time, trying to become something. Here in Satsang, it's reversed. We are not worried about becoming anything in particular or anything because we're already qualified. Let's say somebody wants to take out a loan and the bank says, well, you're not qualified. You need to build your credit up. So what do? We take out, you know, smaller loans and buy things on credit and build our credit up. Then we go to the bank and the bank says, okay, you're qualified. Then we say, okay, that's how the world works now. But it's not like that here. We're already qualified. And there's literally nothing we can do to change that fact. So what are we doing? You know, we're either trying to qualify ourselves or disqualify ourselves. Neither way works, right? There are some that are trying to disqualify themselves. And they don't trick the teachers, the gurus at all. That's why the gurus are not unhappy. There are a lot in this world and in the cosmos that are desperately trying to disqualify themselves so they can never remember what they are. They will say, oh, you know, I'm not qualified, you know, I'm look what I've done. Look at the life I've led. I'm not qualified to remember what I am. And there are others who are trying desperately to qualify. They say, I know I want to remember what I am, and I'm trying to qualify for that. And again, there's no way to qualify for it. There's no way to be disqualified from it. It just seems rather, I don't know, amusing in some way. I guess the sheer folly of it, you know, of existence is funny. We can't disqualify ourselves. We're frantically trying to do so. Maybe when we die we say, okay, I've been disqualified. Or when we die, we say, okay, I've been qualified. No. Doesn't make any difference one way or the other. We cannot qualify ourselves. We cannot disqualify ourselves. So why do we need to be born? Why do we need to die? Why do we need to do anything? We don't. We can do whatever we want to do, but it has no bearing on our qualification. No bearing on our access. no bearing on our acceptance from this overlay. We're already accepted. Everyone is already accepted. 100% with unqualified. With no restrictions. No requirements. None. Zero. And there's nothing we need to remember once we choose to experience this. We don't need to worry about, well, wait a minute, I forgot something. I forgot my password. I forgot how I got in here. I forgot what is the requirement, what worked. Okay, so we're looking at it at a slightly different angle right now. Is that we're basically, we can be right there and not do it. Because we're frantically trying to drill into our minds what worked so that when we start experiencing it, we'll know what worked, what got us there. And if we should drop out, we'll know how to get back in. We got to know what worked for. We got to remember, what is it that I did to enable this? The answer is we didn't need to do anything. It doesn't make any difference. What we thought we did. We don't, nothing to remember. But we're afraid. We're afraid we'll forget. How do we succeed? Well, you know, gotta remember that. It's very important. We don't need any success. There's nothing to remember because there's no way into it. Other than realizing there's no requirements into it. You know, there's no way. It's already here. There's no path into it. It's always here. With no requirements. The overlay is not going to ask you what path did you use to get here? They're not gonna ask any questions. That's pretty amazing. Very amazing. Very amazing discovery awaits us. That which is questionless. That which neither asks answers nor requires answers. Asks questions or requires answers. No requirements at all. None. It's just there for us. I guess it's something that analogous to that would be like the air we're breathing. You know, we're just breathing all the time, right? And the air is not asking us to breathe or charging us a toll. Although some would like to probably put a tax on the air we breathe. But the air itself is not asking that. It's like an analogy. When we say we've lost our minds, meaning we're not thinking about our qualifications. We're not thinking about what questions to ask or what we need to answer. We're not thinking or not trying to remember how we got there or how we can stay there. All of that, we're not doing any of that. And people will say, well, you've lost your mind then. Well, that type of mind isn't required. The overlay doesn't require that. It doesn't require anything from us. It's just there. Always will be there. So basically, everybody has a flirtation with this. And but very few actually drop this flirtation and realize, you know, that's not necessary. but we all will do that. And in fact, we can do that. We can. We're closing in on that. We're closing in on realizing we don't need to close in on anything. We can give up the search. We can give up the effort. Remember, the overlay is already there. It's there. And when we give up the effort to qualify ourselves or disqualify ourselves, then we experience what is there. It's not like a vacuum we experience, like nothing is there. The overlay is there. So we won't fall into a vacuum of nothingness, of no experiencing. The overlay cannot say this because it cannot speak, it cannot say anything. But we can say that. Don't even have to have a Harley to experience it. Don't have to go on a ride. We don't have to get rid of our Harleys either. Nobody has to do anything. Always, that's always the case. Always the case that nobody has to do anything. And whatever they're doing, that's not disqualifying them at all. Neither is it qualifying them. They don't have to do anything. The access is already immaculately there. The door is always completely wide open. There isn't even any door. It's the doorless door. No understanding required. The presence is there. It's felt. It's experienced. Doesn't require understanding to experience it. Understanding is really trying to meet a requirement, right? Like to say, oh, I got it. I feel qualified now. Or a way to maintain qualification. You see people attending seminars, they're so intent. Because they feel, I got in here, paid my ticket, got in, here's the teacher on the stage, and I feel kind of qualified because I'm educated and I'm with my peer group here. I feel I fit in with this peer group, the social strata, and so I feel kind of qualified, but I gotta, make sure I listen real carefully and intently to maintain my qualification. I don't wanna, I gotta absorb this and make sure that I, feel, keep this feeling of being qualified. And then I need to buy the book and read it, and that's a way of also maintaining my qualification for this. So I need to understand what's going on. I need to understand the world. No understanding of the world is required. No understanding of any teacher is required, or of any book is required. None. Don't have to have any of that. Ananda Mayama couldn't read or write, had no guru, had no teacher, had no qualifications at all, because she knew she didn't need them. Had no social standing, really nothing. Didn't need them. Perfectly aware of that fact. We don't need them either. We don't need to stop going to seminars or doing things or reading books or whatever. We don't need to do that either. There's nothing to understand. We don't need to understand anything about the world. Zero understanding is required. Not that we get rid of our understanding. It's just simply, it's not needed. The stillness doesn't need to be understood. We don't need to impress the stillness with our understanding of the world. We don't need to go in and say, stillness, I've reached a very high level of quietude in my life. I've meditated for a long time. I understand the world and all this stuff. And, you know, stillness, it doesn't need to be impressed. It can't be impressed. It just remains as it is. So we don't have to put on a song and dance of understanding. We don't have to go in and say, well, I've been studying the course for 20 years and attended a lot of workshops and meetings and stuff. And, you know, is that impressive? And the stillness, no reaction. And we might think, oh my gosh, maybe I have to study it for several more decades, and maybe I haven't met the right teacher yet, because this doesn't impress the stillness. Ah, the stillness cannot be impressed. It simply remains as it is. What impressed me about Ananda Mayama, she always remained exactly as she is. And I saw that, I say, wow, now that impresses me. That's very impressive. How's that possible? No alteration. I didn't see anything causing any change or alteration. How's that possible? Well, she knows that she doesn't need to impress anyone to know what she is, know that she is spirit. No qualifications are required. And we don't need to impress the stillness. The stillness is unimpressionable. We cannot impress upon it anything. And yet we may feel impressed by that fact for a while, you know. We may feel, wow, that's very impressive. That's how I felt with Ananda Mayama, is that, wow, she's very, 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 very impressive. And off the charts, incredibly impressive. I'm so impressed. It's amazing. Well, how is that possible? I couldn't come up with an answer, really. That's what was so impressive. I said, this is not really answerable in terms of any thing that we would expect as an answer. It's beyond that. There's something beyond. There's something that we are unaware of. There's something going on here that needs to be clarified, because it's very impressive. Very impressive that someone realizes that they don't need to impress at all in order to be what they are, already are. That's exactly the condition we're in. We don't need to impress the overlay with what we are. We don't need to say, hey, overlay, you know who we are? We're spirit, you know. The overlay already knows. The overlay is one with what we are. The overlay is an expression of what we are, an extension. It's the effect of an idea that we choose, not to be prime creator, just to be what we are. So there's no way to impress. And we might think, again, we might think that means that we're not qualified. We say, oh my gosh, I didn't impress the overlay. I didn't impress it. I didn't impress the teacher, you know. We go to a teacher and we try to impress them, and they're unimpressed. And we think, uh-oh, I really don't have it yet. I've got to do some more study. I've got to really upgrade, do a lot of work, qualify myself at a much higher level. But the fact is, what the teacher is saying is that you don't need to impress anyone. Give up the attempt to impress. There's no need to impress. You are already spirit. Why does spirit need to impress? So we go to see the teacher. The teacher's unimpressed. We can take it two ways. We can take it that, boy, we're really kind of failing, not there yet. Or we can say, maybe the teacher is just reminding us that impression is not required. Being impressive, finding a way to impress the overlay is not necessary. It's not required. the fact that the overlays everything and is completely unmodifiable, that is impressive. That reminds us of what we are. So the reminder of what we are makes a strong impression upon us, but we don't have to make a strong impression upon the overlay. You see, it's not reciprocal. Creation is not reciprocal. Very important. God created spirit, but spirit didn't create God. The overlay reminds us of what we are, but we don't remind the overlay of what it is. You see? Nothing we need to do, therefore. We don't need to try to remind the overlay. Hey, overlay, you reminded us of what we are, now we're going to remind you of what you are. Well, the overlay already knows what it is, because it's not being modified. There's no substituting taking place. It's not being substituted for. It's not like the Prime Creator created Spirit, and then Spirit has to reciprocate and say, okay, Prime Creator, now I'm going to create you. I'm going to create Prime Creator. That's not how reality works. Prime Creator creates Spirit, and then Spirit says, I'm going to function as you created me to extend the creation. So we do not have to find a way to remind the perfect stillness that it is perfect stillness. We don't have to remember how we got there. We don't have to be impress the stillness, and we don't have to remind the stillness of what it is. So all these different factors, we're drawing them in. Satsang draws in all these factors, and we realize all these factors are in play, keeping us our reluctance there. They're all in play. All the time. These factors are in play. And so being reminded of this is very helpful. Not that this will prevent them from being in play, they still will be in play. But again, we don't need to drop any of this as a requirement. We're not required to do anything, because that perfect stillness is not requiring anything of us. So it's there without requirements, without condition, unconditional presence. No, it doesn't recognize status of any kind. Because within itself, there is no status, there's no modification, there are no levels. It is a seamless oneness. And so, that is the truth. And that is time well spent. Very well spent. All around here, you know, the airplane is flying overhead and it's full of passengers, and they're jetting somewhere. And they've got their, you know, their MP3 players, and they're hooked up to listening to music. If they can do that on a plane, I don't know. Eating the peanuts, drinking something, looking out the window, thinking what they're going to be doing, all this stuff. I mean, they're on their way somewhere. They're qualifying themselves somehow, or disqualifying themselves somehow. They're active with that. But the teachers walk around. They move around, but they don't move around with the intent of trying to qualify or disqualify themselves. So sure, they can go get in a car, they can go somewhere, etc. But it seems like nothing changes for them. Whether they go somewhere or not makes no difference. Because they know they're pre-qualified. There's no call for them to do anything to qualify or disqualify themselves. They're in that steady state, abiding in the feeling of perfect oneness, perfect stillness, perfect emptiness, perfect spaciousness, pure awareness, pure consciousness, nirvana, vision of Christ, vision of oneness, seamless peace beyond understanding, the overlay. They're experiencing that effect, non-modifiable effect, the effect of not trying to be prime creator. They know they're pre-qualified, don't have to do anything. No requirements are required. Nothing is required of them. Nothing. And so they're very happy. They're very relaxed. They're at peace. Whether they go somewhere or not, they're still very happy, very relaxed, because they know this wonderful fact. They've realized this. And they've realized that wherever they go, everything they meet and see is also pre-qualified and has no requirements on it, free of all requirements. And so they're delighted by this. They're meeting everywhere they go, they meet themselves. They meet those who are exactly the same, in the exact same boat, pre-qualified, no requirements. Are required. They're unconditionally, have unconditional access. Everywhere they go, that's all they meet. Everyone they meet, they say, ah, here's another who has unconditional access and is pre-qualified. How wonderful. So they're very happy to see everyone, because that's what they're seeing. You see, these are really the very vital points to touch upon. We're touching upon this. Vitally important. It's always vitally important, because existence is really, trying to be what we're not is really hell. Really is. And sometimes hell doesn't seem quite as bad as other times. Sometimes it seems really bad. Sometimes the activity of trying to disqualify oneself from being what one is becomes very intense. And that's the times we live in right now. And other times it seems to be less intense. People aren't so frantically active to disqualify themselves. And sometimes people become frantically active to qualify themselves, tell you the truth. The 60s were a lot like that. In the early 70s, and there have been times where everyone was just like, wow, we gotta, you know, we're aware that this presence is available to us because of the great teachers like Ramana Maharshi and Anamaya Ma and the other ones and the others. And we became aware of it. Wow. We said, okay, what do we got to do to qualify for this? And became very active, very intense, you know. I read, you know, thousands of books. Really. I did everything I could possibly do to qualify myself, you know. Sat in a room, studying A Course in Miracles. Everything I did, every day, everything was dedicated to trying to get qualified. And so there's so many people were, you know, doing whatever they could do, so much during those times. And it was really painful. It was very stressful, very difficult. And then the tide turned, and now we have those who are very intent on trying to disqualify themselves. Disqualification is in fashion in this world right now. And the way to have peace of mind and be untroubled by whatever happens is to realize it's impossible to disqualify oneself. It's impossible to qualify. We're all pre-qualified. And so nothing that anyone is doing is having any effect on what we are. It's having no effect on the overlay. It's having no effect on the fact that we have unconditional access to remember what we are, to the overlay. Doesn't change any of that in the slightest bit. So really nothing is changing here from this standpoint. From this standpoint, nothing is changing. Not a thing is changing. And we can simply abide in that realization. because it's a fact. And therefore one will abide in bliss, very blissful condition, without being troubled by anything that takes place, because they're simply basing their how they feel on the facts, on what is true. Nobody is doing any harm to their qualification, because there's zero qualification. How can you do harm to zero? The overlay is there, already present, without any conditions at all. So how can we default on that? How can we turn away from that? We cannot. It doesn't turn away from us. It's still there. We can turn away, but it's still 100% unconditionally there. So who's in trouble? No one's in trouble. From that standpoint, looking at it from reality, no one's in trouble. No one's in bad circumstances. No such thing. Everyone's in perfect situation. Perfectly qualified, pre-qualified, already, always will be that way, always. Can't change, cannot change. So literally there's no change taking place in the universe whatsoever. On the essential truth, there's no change taking place at all. And there you go. Seeing it from the standpoint of realization of truth, then there's a different perspective on the entire everything. Will bring peace of mind. We could realize that we really can be happy all the time. What's not to be happy about? The fact that we're all pre-qualified is never changing, unchanging. That's something to be happy about, very happy. Why do we need to think about anything else? There's really nothing else to think about. Because this doesn't change, this can't be modified. So it's always this way. So what else is there to think about? We cannot think about, well, what if it wasn't this way? Because that's meaningless. So really unhappy thoughts really don't arise. They don't need to arise at all. So we're getting there. The satsang is really getting there. And as I've said, the situation in this world has turned towards attempt to disqualify. Very, very severe attempts to disqualify. And of course, if one believes that one must qualify, then that's a very frightening thing. So how this satsang is helping is to point out to you that you don't need to qualify, you're pre-qualified. So no matter what people do to try to disqualify themselves, that doesn't affect you at all, doesn't affect truth at all. You're still perfectly qualified. Your pre-qualification cannot be harmed in any way. No one can do anything to it. No one can do anything to the overlay, nor to the fact you're pre-qualified, nor to the fact that the overlay is unconditional. Unconditional access for all, eternally, forever. No change. Nothing can happen to that. So you're not really in danger of losing anything. No one is in danger of losing anything. These facts remain. They cannot be lost. Nobody has ever lost anything. You know, people think they've lost something and they're trying to find it. I think, well, I was qualified, but now I lost it. So I gotta find what happened to it. What happened to my qualification? No. We're pre-qualified. Cannot lose it. So we don't need to search for it. Nothing needs to be found. The belief that we lost it is delusion. Cannot lose it. How can we lose zero? I can't say, where did it go? It's over there, it's over there. You know, I need to find it. I need to find zero. We're all frantically looking for it. And we go to teachers listening, and you know, we think maybe they'll tell us where it is. We can finally, if we're good enough and they think we're ready for it, they'll tell us where that zero is. We'll find it. Now, they'll tell us right off the bat, zero can't be found. It's not there to be found. Unconditional means there are no conditions, so there's no, you can't find where that, where the unconditioned is, where, you know, because there isn't any conditions to find. Cannot locate zero, can't find it. It just simply means it's not required to find anything. It's like the ocean is there. And we just simply can go and swim in the ocean. It's just there. The ocean is not requiring anything from us, you know. It's not requiring we do something. It's not like the ocean is not there and we need to find it in order for it to be there. It's there. We need simply to go to the ocean and go in the ocean, but it's already there. The overlay is already here. It's not going anywhere. There's nowhere for it to go because it overlays everything. It's seamless. We don't need to find it, it's already here. We just need to turn our attention to it. We need to give up the search to find it, as it were. Give up the search to find our qualifications that we think we've misplaced. Give up the search to remember our password that we think we need to use. The key. We need to find the key. What do we do with it? You know, where is it? It's like someone who's desperately searching for their key. And they finally realize that they're actually already inside the house. They see the door, and, you know, I'm not sure where the key is. I can't find it. It's terrible. They're already inside. Don't need the key. We're already what we are. We just need to remember that. And the overlay gives us that reminder. So there you go. It's, we will certainly continue on with even more better clarifications. That's always the way. But we've certainly are treading on in the right area, so to speak. We're treading in the area of realizing that there's nowhere that we need to tread. Okay. Very great. That's it.